fun was really a swing to delight. On a spree every night, but she sure didn't fight when he kissed her. Three blondes in his life. For a gasser with class, one was bright. Though she took him apart from the start, he just could not resist her. There were more, you have guessed, for his passion for blondes was obsession. And he'd go into gear every time one came near, wrong or right. Three blondes in his life. One was cool and real kind, like a friend. She was honest except for the secret she kept to the end. For the blonde in his life, who became his dear wife and died to please him, was the real gold brunette. And she may love him yet, more fool.
Jet age. It's really a wonderful way to travel, except it gets you around too fast. I'm Duke Wallace, insurance investigator, better known on radio and TV as a private eye. Last week, Bombay. Yesterday, Johannesburg. And now? Well, now we're approaching New York City. I've given up trying to figure out where I'll be next. Because every time I start to like a place, the boss call sends me someplace else. Well, like now. It's cocktail time in Johannesburg. And Roseanne didn't like it a bit when I had to break our date. But that happens. Rogers just calls and says, get yourself back to New York on the next plane. So here I am. I only hope his ulcers aren't kicking up again, because he can be most disagreeable.
I got your message.
I can put up with anything but stupidity.
What happened?
Well, one of Kelly's operators disappeared. He mentions it casually in his report. Dear Mr. Rogers, one of our investigators, a William Collins, has disappeared. He told his wife he was going out of town on agency business. I assume there is no connection between his disappearance and the agency. This seems to be strictly domestic and no concern of ours. Seems... assumes. You get out to Los Angeles and find that man. Find him and fire him. And fire Kelly, too.
Why Kelly?
Collins' wife thinks that her husband went away on agency business. It doesn't matter that Kelly told her that he didn't. She thinks he did. And she's going to be telling anyone that'll listen to her that he disappeared because of the job that he was working on. If she starts talking, the agency's going to be laughed out of town. Now, you find that man, and find him quick. And keep his wife from blabbing, too.
Mary.
Yes, sir?
Make me a plane reservation for Los Angeles, so I can leave this evening.
Yes, sir.
And Duke, don't bother to look into Dino's or into the Crescendo. You won't find him there.
Well, don't worry, Chief, I'll find him. No matter what it costs you.
Rogers could have done was given me one night in New York. There's a redhead there that I'll never forget as long as I live. I may have to. Probably a blonde this week. In 4 hours, I'll be in Los Angeles. Los Angeles. Constance. No. Anne. Annabelle Hickson. From Mobile. She's a real peach in more ways than one. I think I'll call her first. Well, that is, if I get a chance. Kelly will probably meet me at the airport with a bag of apples and start yakking about Rogers and never give me 2 minutes to myself.
Boy, am I glad to see you. see you. What a stinking mess. The old man cracking up?
Yeah.
Good.
Wednesday the 10th, Collins didn't report for work. Saturday the 13th, his wife called the office and asked me where her husband was. She said that Tuesday night, I think the 9th, he packed the suitcase at 8 o'clock, said he was being sent out of town by the agency for an assignment. Said he'd probably be back on Friday. Kissed her goodbye and left. I told her that the agency didn't send her husband out of town for an assignment. And matter of fact, his last assignment was on Friday the 5th. She said, well, where do you suppose he went? I said, I haven't got the slightest idea. Anybody call me?
No, Mr. Kelly. Welcome back. I've been waiting for you. No cream or sugar.
As usual?
As usual.
Thanks.
I checked all the cases that Collins had worked on. There were 4. His first job for us was strong arm. He was a bodyguard for a witness in a fraud case. Case number 2, a jewel case. Lost, strayed, or stolen. Collins made an investigation, discovered no evidence of anything. We kept the case open on our books, but the insurance company paid off anyway. Number 3, a routine double indemnity auto accident. Collins' check concurred with that of the police, who were satisfied it was just what it looked like. Case closed. 4, the bank messenger deal from New York. Collins held the stakeout until we established positive identification. He was relieved Friday the 5th. That's about all there is. Why don't we take a look through his locker? Now, Monday and Tuesday, he spent here waiting in a bullpen. I told him I might send him to San Diego.
Did you?
Well, how could I? He didn't show up after Tuesday.
Today's the 15th. That means he's been missing for 6 days.
Very brilliant, my dear Watson.
Yeah.
That's his wife.
Well, even in a snapshot, this is a very interesting woman. You never met her?
No, but she sounds delicious over the telephone.
You know, Collins might have taken a powder. He might have even taken a powder with another woman. But that other woman would have to have something that's not there.
Boy, you know it.
Was he ambitious?
Well, isn't everybody?
I mean ambitious for money.
Well, he had expensive clothes. He went in for the finer things in life. You know, gold cigarette lighter, stuff like that.
There's got to be money in this someplace. He had a lot to come home to. You know, Rogers is really blowing his top.
Oh, yeah, I meant to ask you about that. What about me?
You're fired.
Oh, thanks a lot. I'm sorry I asked.
Think nothing of it.
Well, maybe I'll write our friend Mr. Rogers a nice letter now. There's a few things I've been saving up to say to him. Drop dead, you louse. Rude letter will follow. You want an apple?
No, thanks. Forget it. When the old man cools down, he'll forget it. I'm going to take the company car, go back to the hotel and drop my things off. Then I'm going to go see Mrs. Collins.
Call me later.
Hello.
Lois Collins?
Yes.
I'd like to talk to you about your husband.
Come on in.
Was he back yet?
No, he isn't. Won't you sit down?
Thank you.
Would you care for a drink?
A bourbon. Bourbon and water, if you have it.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to tell me, or shall I ask questions?
What do you mean?
You and Bill happy together?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Were you?
Well, we were married when Bill was working for Holland Company in Seattle. I thought I was in love, and so did he. We were married a year when Bill enlisted in the Navy.
That's an old excuse.
He did shore patrol work in Seattle, and then later he was transferred to San Francisco. We didn't see much of each other. I worked days, he worked nights. Oh, I knew he was playing around, but I didn't know what I could do about it. Outside of leaving him, I didn't want to do that.
Why not?
Well, he needed me. He always came back to me. I didn't want to hurt him.
Yeah.
Well, Bill was pretty wrapped up in some blonde singer. Well, by this time, I realized that Bill was obsessed with blondes. From everything I could piece together, all of his interests seemed to center on blondes.
Is that why you became a blonde?
You can't blame a girl for trying. Well, anyway, it didn't do much good. We talked about divorce, and I made up my mind to file. But I just didn't get around to it. When I finally decided, he'd already broken with a singer. He quit his job, and we moved down here. He was always restless. He was always talking about moving someplace else. For a while, he worked for a small agency, and then he got unsteady with your company. Just about that time, I realized he was involved with another woman.
How'd you know?
Oh, I could tell the minute it started. He said it was his work that kept him out late. I knew better. Well, I finally made up my mind to file. But I don't know, I just didn't get around to it. Now I will. Do you want another drink?
Yes, please. What makes you so sure that you'll go through with the divorce this time?
You know, I'll tell you something I learned about him by experience. Women, just women, they didn't interest him very long, maybe 3 weeks or a month. Then he was home again until a new one caught his fancy. But if she was blonde and had money, could buy him things like that singer did, he'd stick around until they dropped him. But when this one drops him, he's not going to crawl back to little Lois. I've had it.
Took you a long time to make up your mind.
Yeah, I guess it did. I did everything I could to hold on to him. I even became a blonde. Didn't work.
Maybe it's all for the best.
I'm glad you came. You're so understanding.
What does Collins want that he doesn't have? Certainly not love or affection. Because Lois has plenty of that. Money. Well, that's an item that his wife Lois doesn't have. Maybe money is a lead to Collins.
Yeah, I've just been rereading Collins' report on a jewel robbery case. It reads like fish smell. Listen to this. Now, wait a minute. Betty, come in here. Oh, put the coffee down. I want you to sit here. You're Mrs. Carr. Kelly, Sit here, Mr. Carr. Reconstruction. Now, they stopped at the Sportsman for a nightcap about 1 in the morning, parked in the empty lot next to the bar, didn't lock the car, no attendant in the lot. They had one drink at the place and then started home. The spot was about 3 miles from their house. As they were driving, Mr. Carr noticed that the rear vision mirror had been taken from the car. About a half a mile from the bar, they turned into a side street. A man in the back seat stuck an automatic against Mr. Carr's neck and told both of them not to turn around and to drive slowly. Now, he told Mrs. Carr to take the diamond pendant off that she was wearing. It was insured for $25,000. She removed it and handed it to the man. Now, he told Mr. Carr to stop. He opened the door, got out, told him to drive fast, not to look around or not to turn back, or he'd let lead fly. Mr. Carr drove home as quickly as possible, phoned the police who alerted patrol cars, but they didn't pick up the robber. Now, that's Mrs. Carr's story, and it's corroborated by her husband. And it's as phony as Hollywood snow. Any good detective would have laughed at it unless he had a reason not to.
She told the story both times, and both times it was straightforward.
Yes. And both times she said that the man has stuck an automatic in the back of her husband's neck. If she told the story in her own words, it's reasonable to assume that she would have said that the man stuck a gun in the back of her husband's neck. The word automatic was someone else's word. Someone that wanted an automatic in the car that night because he probably owned a .32 special revolver. So, I'm going to go visit Mrs. Carr. My name is Duke Wallace. I'd like to see Mrs. Carr.
I'm Mr. Wallace to see you, Mrs. Carr.
Show him in.
Won't you come in?
Thank you. I didn't mean to disturb you, but it's about the stolen jewelry.
Stolen jewelry?
You did have some jewelry stolen.
Sit down, please.
Thank you.
You from the police?
The insurance company.
I don't understand. I received a check weeks ago.
We never close a case until the jewelry's been picked up. Oh, the insurance company pays off, but we keep working.
I see.
It's mostly negative work. We circulate a description of the article, keep an eye on the well-known fences, and let it go at that. It shows up sooner or later, altered or broken down some way, but it turns up.
Has mine turned up?
No.
Let me fix you a drink.
Oh.
Duke?
Yeah.
Kelly, they found Collins.
Tell him his wife's divorcing him.
Operator, you cut me off from room 24. It's too late. He's dead. Oh, talk to me, boy.
Where'd they find him?
The San Bernardino Mountains, about 50 miles from here. I'm going to run over there. You want to come along?
Yeah, I'll pick me up in 20 minutes.
Good.
How did Collins die?
I don't know a thing about it. All I know is the body was found in a cabin. The phone connection was very bad.
Mr. Kelly?
Hi, Sheriff.
This is Duke Wallace from our eastern office.
Mr. Wallace?
Yeah?
You better ride with me. They're still working on the road. It's dangerous. Your car will be all right over there. The place where we found the body is the Bailey place. It's the first place you come to on the other road.
Whose place?
Bailey place.
Go ahead.
The place is usually closed up in the winter. I ain't never going to make a real summer place out of it, neither. The lake's too cold. You can't do that here. It's fire restriction.
What?
Fire restriction.
Who found the body?
I'm getting to the body. Joe Randall found it. He gets paid to keep an eye on the places over here. Comes over once a week. Well, he was passing the Bailey place and swung his flashlight around and seen the door was open, so he went in and there was the body. Dead body. Well, then the damn fool got excited and got his car stuck in the mud. It was almost an hour before he could get it out and get over to my place. I come over and what with one thing and another, it's after 2 o'clock in the morning before I can get talking to you people. Seems like everything happened. Elsie down at the phone place couldn't get through to Los Angeles for 2 hours because of some kind of trouble.
You sweet on Elsie?
Well, she's not my type exactly.
What do you call this side of the lake, Sheriff?
Lakeview.
Lakeview. So didn't Collins spend a week at Lakeview with a fraud case witness named Bailey?
Yeah.
First thing we get back to the office, let's check the file on that case. Getting anything?
Yeah, one clear print on the inside, but just smears on the outside.
Is the table clean?
Yeah, I checked all that.
Get anything off of this?
Oh, I couldn't get much.
No. What about the matches?
Just smears. In fact, I've checked everything in the house now. I think I better go out and check the car.
Canned vegetables, eggs, quart of milk, head of lettuce, bunch of onions, bread, a roast.
Now, if you could only cook.
Sure.
Is that important?
Could be.
Plenty of Collins' effects around, but no sign of anyone else. But a woman's got to figure in this somehow. The lighter. Matches. And the groceries. They all point to it.
Is that the slug?
Yes, I just took it out. I'd say it came out of this gun.
Ballistics have to show if that gun was fired recently. Now, tell us if that slug matches that gun.
Any prints on the gun?
One clear set.
Do you set the time of death?
Matter of days.
Early Wednesday morning, a possibility?
Possibly. We'll take the corpse to town for an autopsy. We'll know a lot more then.
Are you all through in here?
What about the car?
They're working on it now.
Any luck?
Yeah, prints as clear as a bell. Plenty of smears.
Must be Collins.
Yeah, we've covered everything here. Let's get back to town.
Gentlemen are ready to take you back to your car.
Well, thanks for your help, Sheriff.
Town day's work. A little bit of this country air do you city boys a lot of good.
You're right. Why don't we find out how good this country air really is, huh? Nice.
Kelly.
Yeah.
What about the blonde that was at the cabin?
What blonde?
Blonde that was with Collins at the cabin.
Look, what did you find to prove there was a blonde?
Several things.
For instance,
take the groceries. A man would buy canned meat, canned vegetables, the eggs, milk, bread. Might even buy chops or a steak. But a woman would buy green vegetables, make a salad. And a woman would buy a roast.
Oh, come on. What about the blonde?
Oh, then there was the book of matches and the cigarette lighter.
What about the blonde?
The cigarette lighter didn't work very well. It needed fluid. To a man, this would be a challenge. Try it several times. If it didn't work, he'd turn it upside down, he'd shake it. He'd make it work if it was possible. A woman wouldn't bother. She'd try it a couple of times. If it didn't work, she'd use the matches. And there were several used matches in the ashtray. Now, the book of matches smelled like they'd been in a woman's purse. The scent of a light perfume, usually worn by blondes.
Okay, let's assume you're right. There was a blonde. How did she get back to town from the cabin in the mountains?
She had help.
Now you got two people up there besides Collins. And all out of that pointy little head of yours.
Yeah, she had help. I don't think any woman would drive those mountain roads in a blacker night. Even to have fun.
So?
So Collins drove her up there.
Yeah, I don't buy that.
You know, it takes two mighty smart people to spend any amount of time in a place and not leave any definite clues. Those two almost did.
What do you mean?
Well, the groceries are another angle. She didn't know whether she was going to stay or not, but she made sure if she did stay, she was going to eat on her vacation.
What makes you so sure she was a blonde?
Pattern. Collins got something pretty nice at home. But I figure it's another blonde.
You know, if any one of your hunches pay off, I'm going to treat you to a case of good booze.
I'll buy that. I think you'd better go see Lois Collins and break the news. Oh. Be nice to her, huh? And you can drive her to San Bernardino. The police will probably want her to identify the body.
Oh, thanks a lot. For your information, I'm going to let Benny drive her, if you don't mind.
All right. Meantime, I'm going to look for a blonde. Or two. Three. Collins was murdered.
Murdered? Oh, no.
Honey, you should have asked who's Bill Collins.
But I know. The detective. The one from the insurance company. Of course I know.
Well, according to our report, you only saw him twice. And neither time for any longer than I've been here. And that was several days ago.
If I left now and tomorrow morning somebody told you that Duke Wallace had been murdered, you'd ask who's Duke Wallace.
I remember Mr. Collins.
Well, I'll buy that. But not from the two times that he talked over the case with you. Maybe other times when the two of you were alone together.
I don't like that implication, Mr. Wallace.
I don't either. But I've got a very strong feeling about you. And I don't think that Collins just walked up to you on the street and out of a hot brain flash said, Sweetie, you've got a jewel. Let's rig a robbery. You'll get part of the take, and the insurance company will give you a new jewel. No, I think the two of you are real palsy together.
I think that I don't have to stand here and listen to your ravings, Mr. Wallace.
You don't have to listen to anything. But I'll tell you what we are going to do. We're going to dig. And we're going to find out when, where, and just how well you knew Bill Collins. And we're going to find out where he might have been the night of the robbery. And then we're going to find out how much you needed the money. Or maybe how much your husband needed the money, because he may have been on the game, too. And then we're going to find out if Bill Collins got nasty and you had to pay him off to shut him up. And then we're going to see if you were at Lakeview. And if you were, we're going to hang a murder rap on you. Now, sweetheart, you don't have to listen to a word I say. I just want to know what you're going to order for your last meal.
You really don't have anything. Even if you find that I knew Bill Collins before, it wouldn't prove a thing.
He was murdered, Mrs. Carr.
Martha, can I call you Duke?
Sure. But Bill was murdered.
I'm sorry. I liked him. But I don't know anything about any murders or jewel robberies.
Where were you Tuesday night, the 9th?
Well, it's kind of a silly question for a girl who doesn't keep a diary.
Maybe you should. Try to remember. A week ago tonight.
Oh. That's the night I took my husband to the airport. Trying to remember what I did. What time are you most interested in?
All night.
Well, I took my husband to the airport. He left at 7. Then I had dinner. And then I came home. I didn't go out again.
Servants can verify it.
I'm afraid not. We have just the maid and the cook, and both of them sleep out. So I'm afraid I haven't an alibi.
You have everything else? Yes, you have motive, opportunity, and you're smart enough for the part.
You can't be serious, Duke. Let me fix you a drink.
Bourbon. Husband back yet?
No, he's still in New York. He won't be back for 10 days or so. Isn't that wonderful? My time is my own.
Now, this Bailey, who owned the cabin, has been in Chicago for a month. He made quite a statement, too. And it all boils down simply to the fact that Collins knew that the key to the Lakeview house was hidden in a flower pot on the front stoop. Hey, boy. Down, boy. Pay attention. Now, it was a very simple thing to find out that Bailey was going to spend an extra month in Chicago. All I had to do was call his office. Collins could have very well done the same thing.
All right. We know where he got the key to get in. We knew how he knew it was safe to be there. Now, Martha, I want you to get everything on her you can. Put some in on her.
You gonna put her on the spot?
If she's guilty, I want her.
Mr. Kelly?
Yeah?
Your vitamin pills are here.
Bring them in.
You know, if one of Collins' reports stink, they all stink. So I'm gonna read you the Fortner accident report.
Oh, please, not again. I've heard it too many times. I got a better idea. Let the doll read it. We'll both listen to it. Go ahead, honey.
On the 24th, the Fortners spent the evening at the Club Casa. They were known there. They came out of the club about 1 in the morning and the attendant brought their car. Miss Fortner started to get into the driver's seat, saying that Fortner was too drunk to drive. He objected. She insisted and finally, failing to get her way, went back into the club and phoned for a taxi. Fortner drove off alone. Mrs. Fortner had kept the cab waiting while she had 2 or 3 drinks with some friends. The friends turned out to be 2 men she'd never met before. She was in the cabin on her way home about 15 minutes after Fortner had gone.
Hold it, honey. Hey, boy, you know you could be arrested for what you're thinking? Go ahead, dear.
The police reported that one of their patrol cars had passed Fortner and the men had recognized the car. The police said there was nothing erratic about Fortner's driving when they saw him. Fortner had apparently driven without incident right to the street that bordered his home, but there, instead of making the turn off into his driveway, he plunged through the guardrail at the end of the street and over the palisade, a drop of 65 feet. He was dead when they removed him from the car. At the time of the accident, Fortner was 62 and Mrs. Fortner 30. Mr. Fortner's estate was about a half a million, not including the $200,000 from us for the accident.
That'll do, dear. You can take the rest of the night off.
Good night.
Good night.
Hey, not there, Dad.
Hey, I said not here, man.
I want to talk to you. You know the Fortners?
Sure, I know them. They used to make it in here quite a bit.
When was the last time you saw
them? Oh, let's see. Yeah, I remember. I think it was the night of the accident. Yeah. Oh, it's funny, man. Like, Miss Fortner wouldn't ride home with the old man because she said he was too crocked.
Was he drunk?
Well, I've seen him worse, you know.
She ever refused to ride home with him before?
No.
Ever?
Look, man, like, I don't know about the times I saw him, you dig? But she never pulled that jazz before that I know about.
When the other detective talked to you, did he ask you about this?
Which detective, Mac?
The private eye.
Yeah, he asked about it, just like you're doing now. And he asked me if I was sure, and I told him just what I told you.
Thanks.
I'm hip, thanks.
You ever watch television?
Yeah, like it's a club, man. It's a club.
So this is Bayville. Pretty exclusive. But then the Fortners could afford it. Or could they? If Helen Fortner is involved with Collins, maybe this is my money motive. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
Bourbon and soda. You Helen Fortner?
Yeah. We met before? Oh, you're handsome. Do you know me? I mean, do I know you?
No, but you're going to.
It's wonderful as long as it's fun. Let's have a drink on it.
Be my pleasure. Like to try bourbon?
All right. Oh, I don't like bourbon. Make it my usual.
Can I come see you tomorrow?
All right. Why tomorrow? Why not tonight?
What time?
Anytime. I'll be waiting.
It takes an olive and a twist of lemon to make a good martini. But it'll only take one good clue to put me on the trail of Collins' murderer. You're sure the Fortners never came in here with anyone else?
They were good customers. And I'd remember if there was anything different or out of line.
I told you the same as I told the other detective. Fortners always left together. Even when he got pretty well oiled, he always seemed to be able to get home. And she always left with him.
Thank you for the information.
This way, sir.
Mrs. Fortner was expecting me.
Sit down.
Helen, you remember Bill Collins?
Oh, yes. That nice man I met after the accident. A detective of some sort. He was so sympathetic.
He's been murdered.
Oh, what a shame.
Remember me, Duke Wallace, Insurance Investigations. I'd like to talk to you about the accident that killed your husband.
I wanted to drive and he wouldn't let me. He was drunk and I wouldn't ride with him.
You'd been drinking.
Oh, yes, but I could have driven.
Your husband usually drink a lot?
Duke, I'm not a child. I understand that you have to ask questions. And I'm trying to help you. But don't treat me as a child.
I'm sorry.
It's all right, dear. Is that all?
I'd like to know where you were Tuesday night. The ninth.
I don't know, dear.
Well, you can remember. Try. Think.
I'll try. When was the ninth?
About a week ago.
Is it terribly important?
Terribly.
I'll try. Oh, dear. I just can't remember. Why don't we ask Louis?
Who's Louis?
My butler. I'm sure he would know. I'll get dressed and we'll ask.
I'll ask. Louis?
Yes, sir.
Can you tell me where Mrs. Fortner was on the night of the 9th?
I'm afraid I can't discuss Mrs. Fortner with you, sir.
You can and you will. In the first place, there's a murder involved. In the second place, if you don't talk to me, you'll talk to the police. Besides, Mrs. Fortner told me to ask you.
Very well, sir. Mrs. Fortner dined at home that night. We served roast duck, sweet potatoes.
She alone?
Yes, sir.
You're sure?
Certain. She dined alone. She complained that the duck was too greasy and that the French dressing was too tart. Would you care to check?
You keep a schedule like this on every meal?
Yes, sir. My wife's system. She cooks. This way we can assure variety and correct any errors.
What about the rest of the evening?
I really couldn't say, sir. Mrs. Lewis and I retired to our apartment as soon as we finished the dishes.
What time did you retire?
If dinner was served at 6:30, we were no doubt in our apartment by 8.
It's not in the book.
No, sir, but I don't remember anything unusual about the evening, and that would be our routine.
Mrs. Fortner go out?
Our apartment's on the far side, sir. I wouldn't know.
Louis, you're going to talk. Not to me, maybe, but to the police. They may have to drag you all the way to San Bernardino, but you're going to talk.
I assure you, sir, I have nothing to talk about. Mrs. Lewis and I retired about 8, unless there's a party and we are needed. We serve breakfast at 9 in the morning, and during our off periods, we are in complete ignorance of what happens here.
Yes. Well, on your on periods, do you often admit men to Mrs. Fortner's bedroom?
I can remember of no other occasion, sir.
Well, there you are, darling. Been looking for you. Did Louis tell you everything I wanted to know? Oh, that's too bad. Aren't you coming back for dinner?
Oh, I have other appointments.
Oh. You'll come back after your appointments, won't you? You will, won't you, dear?
All right. See you at 7.
Louis, Mr. Wallace will be back. Serve at 7. Did you come back for a drink?
No, but it's a good idea. Tell me about singing in San Francisco and dating Bill Collins.
You're determined to be unpleasant. Why?
I'm determined to get some truth into our little conversation. Bill Collins was murdered. And while I personally don't give a hoot, it reflects on the agency, and they're going to pin it on someone. In my book, you fit the part.
And because I knew him in San Francisco, you'll frame me?
No.
Because you and he rigged a robbery, and he wasn't satisfied with his 6,000.
6,000?
He chiseled you.
Look, Duke, you know I knew Collins in San Francisco. My husband knew I wasn't Sweet 16. And he knew about my friendship with Bill.
The robbery.
You're too persistent. How does your supposed robbery connect me with the murder?
You needed money. A sizable amount of money without your husband knowing about it. Probably gambling losses, the horses, the racing form that I saw you with. So you found Collins, or he just happened along, and the two of you arranged the robbery. He cheated you, you pulled it off, and he covered it by investigating.
And by chance, he was assigned to this case?
No. We used 5 full-time investigators. And Collins knew how to pick a time when the other 4 would have assignments and he'd be free. He knew he'd get the case. There wasn't a chance of him missing it.
Well, go on.
Well, about a month later, he put the bite on you for more money and you paid.
Why would I pay?
So he wouldn't tell your husband.
Well, he'd expose himself, wouldn't he?
Only to your husband. And Mr. Carr wouldn't let you go to jail. He'd give you hell, probably, but that wouldn't bother you half as much as the fact that he had a hold on you. Something to control you with. Am I boring you?
No. Go on with your pipe dreams.
When Collins put the second bite on you, you paid, but you put a stop to it by luring him up to Lakeview and shooting him.
You don't believe I killed him? No. Where did I get the money?
Somebody smart took Collins to Lakeview. You're smart.
If I paid him, I must have had money. And if I had money, I didn't need the robbery I was paying him to keep quiet about.
We'll keep digging. We'll keep checking the pawn shops. Maybe we'll come up with the answer to your question.
Thank you, Louis. That'll be all.
Thank you, madam. Good night.
Good night, sir.
Sit over here.
Oh, this is fine. Just comfortable.
Something wrong, dear?
Helen, will you do me a favor?
Yes, what is it?
Will you lend me some money?
How much?
Oh, about 2,000.
Silly boy, you're not serious. If I thought you were, I'd get angry.
No, I'm not serious.
I didn't think so. You shouldn't joke like that. I guess I better go and change into something comfortable.
Potatoes not so hot. Dressing good. Milk for Madame and coffee for Wallace.
Now?
Yeah. I'll see you later.
Later tonight?
It's later.
Tonight.
Some other time. What did you hear from the San Bernardino police?
They like the suicide angle. Did you think of it, Duke?
For a minute.
It sounds too easy.
Prince?
Plenty of Collins. The rest of them were smears. Now, the slug came from the gun, and it was his gun.
Time of death?
Sometime Wednesday morning. Just a guess, though. He was pretty drunk.
Passed out?
I said he was drunk.
Okay.
You don't like the suicide angle, huh?
No, there was somebody with him.
Well, if he was expecting somebody up there, especially a dame, he might have bought the groceries. You know, stuff she told him to pick up. As long as she didn't show, he probably sat around getting loaded, feeling sorry for himself. What'd you get from Collins' wife, Benny?
She'd been told by the time I saw her. She cried a little, but she did again when she saw the body. She was all over it when we got back.
Mm-hmm. Did you get anything out of her at all?
She hasn't got an alibi. She was home all alone on Tuesday night from about 9 o'clock on.
Give her his last week's check. We'll take care of the funeral.
Oh, isn't that sweet? The whole thing gets me right here. You're so generous, Duke.
Yeah, it's only money. What about Martha Carr?
Mrs. Carr had dinner at the Encore, all right. We got a waiter who remembered her because she paid with the 10 spot and forgot to pick up her change.
Is that all?
Right now, yeah.
Good. Why don't you have an apple?
Thanks. I already got one.
Smart aleck. Any more reports from you?
Oh, yeah, I forgot to mention that Collins had 10 grand stashed in the bank.
I wondered when you'd get around to checking that.
Now, his first deposit was 6 grand. That was 3 days after the car robbery. On the 29th of last month, he deposited 3 more thousand, and then on the 3rd of this month, another grand.
Good, now we're rolling. What else?
What about the report to Rogers? You didn't call him.
Let him wait. I got a more important call to make. I think you're very brave. I know how you feel.
In a way, I'm glad it's all over.
Yes, we'll still have to bury the poor guy.
But how? I don't have any money.
Didn't Bill leave you anything?
Memories of blondes and about enough money to last a week.
Would you care to order dinner now, sir?
We'll have dinner later. Would you like a drink?
Oh, I'll just have coffee.
Maybe you should have a drink. Make you feel better.
Bourbon and water.
Make it two, please.
Two bourbons and water? Pretty good, sir.
How are you going to get along?
Oh, Charlie will probably help me.
Charlie? Charlie who?
Oh, Charlie Walsh. Well, he's Bill's best friend. And he made Bill a promise a long time ago that he'd always be around just in case. You know, he just moved into the room above me. I'm sure he'll think of something.
Oh, I'm sure he will. Well, don't worry about the funeral. We'll pick up the expenses.
Oh, Duke, thank you.
Are you sure that Bill didn't have some money in a bank somewhere?
Bill and banks never seem to get together.
Oh.
What's wrong, Duke?
Well, I thought you'd level with me about Bill's bank accounts. I know he had money hidden somewhere. You sure he never talked about it?
What are you talking about? Bill didn't have any money. Well, all he ever gave me was just pin money. I had to scheme to get money for clothes.
Well, I guess I might as well tell you. He had several bank accounts.
Bill?
$10,000. But I'm afraid you won't be able to use it.
So what? Money isn't everything.
Now, this is only a stab in the dark, but let's say, for instance, let's say that Walt and the Fortner dame knocked their husband off.
All right.
Okay? Now, Collins found out about it, found out how it was done, and then decided to cut himself in on the deal.
All right, go ahead.
Go ahead where? Ain't that enough?
Yeah, that's enough. That is, if we can connect Charlie and Helen. The bar contact might be enough. She's the type that goes a long way on a casual acquaintance. Now, say that somebody told her they'd get her husband out of the picture without involving her. She might go along with it. I don't think she's got enough nerve to kill a man herself, but she might help. Charlie follows Fortner home. Fortner gets out of the car, goes into the house. Charlie saps him, dunks him into the car, heads it for the cliff.
Forget it.
What's the matter?
You didn't see the medical report. Fortner didn't get sapped. He had no head injuries at all. Had a broken arm.
You're a big help. You make it real tough. You got an idea how it happened?
No, that's one of the weak spots.
Yes, well, there's another weak spot, too.
Only one thing bothers me, that mountain trip.
Well, Collins could have told either one of the blondes about the cabin. Yes, and for Martha, the timing would have been absolutely perfect. Her husband was going out of town. That would have left her free to spend a couple of days at Lakeview. Now, with Helen, she'd go anywhere, anytime that anybody asked her to. But the cabin is what bothers me. There's something wrong with it.
You got a hunch?
Maybe. Anyway, we can't do anything about either one of the two blondes until we find out if the Fortner case was kosher. Now, if it wasn't, Helen has got a motive. But the whole thing hinges on the accident and what Collins found out.
Well, listen, if he'd have found anything, we'd have found it out too, wouldn't we?
That's what I said, remember?
Yeah, that's probably where I heard it.
I just got a hot flash from the airport. Henry Carr didn't leave that Tuesday night. He left on the noon flight next day.
You're fired. Why don't you get lost?
We don't need another suspect. Hello, Martha. Duke Wallace. The night you took your husband to the airport, did you see him get on the plane?
Well, I did what I always do. I left him at the airport. The plane was leaving in 10 minutes or so, so I didn't park. Why do you ask?
Routine.
He got back this morning. You can see him at his office.
Talk to you later.
Where are you going?
See Mr. Carr.
Yes?
My name is Duke Wallace, insurance investigator. I'd like to talk to Mr. Carr.
I'm Mr. Wallace to see you, Mr. Carr.
Send him in.
Won't you go in, please?
Mr. Carr?
Yes. Won't you sit down?
Did you know that Bill Collins was murdered?
Yes, I do. Well, I don't see what possible connection I could have with the murder, Mr.
Wallace.
Well, the possible connection is the fact that you didn't leave for New York on the plane when your wife took you to the airport.
Well, I...
That night, a man was murdered. And the man that was murdered knew your wife.
What are you trying to get at?
Well, the thing that I'm trying to get at is the fact that your wife knew the man that was murdered. As a matter of fact, she knew him before she married you. They were very friendly in San Francisco when she was singing up there.
Well, I knew she had friends up there, of course, but I didn't know any of them. I don't even remember her saying that she'd known Collins before.
Where were you the night that you were supposed to be on the plane to New York?
That's none of your business.
Well, it is my business. You didn't leave on the plane for New York the night that your wife took you to the airport. Maybe you found out that she was going to take a little trip with an old friend. And maybe you followed her.
Well,
now I know where your Mr. Carr was the night he was supposed to be on the airplane.
What did you do to him?
I'll bet it wasn't the first time he wasn't where he was supposed to be. See you sometime.
Get out of here! Oh, your poor head. Poor head.
Lois, I've got to ask you some questions. Well, I hope I didn't interrupt anything.
Who's this?
Oh, he's from Bill's investigating agency.
Who's that?
Charlie.
Charlie Walsh. Live here? I got a room upstairs. Cozy. You trying to make something out of it?
Charlie, please.
Lois, when was the last time you saw your husband?
Tuesday night. He left here at 8:30.
Why?
He said he had to go.
No, I mean, why do you answer every time I ask her a question?
I was here when Bill left, that's why.
Ah.
Stay all night?
Now,
what
wait
do you
a minute,
mean,
bud.
That's a...
Well, how else would you have known whether he came home that night or not?
Lois told me. See?
I want her to tell me. See?
He didn't come home.
You know, I should have brought a lunch. That is, if it takes as long to get the answers to the rest of my questions.
Wise guy, hmm?
How do you make him crawl back in the woodwork?
Charlie, you better go, please.
I ought to punch him in the nose.
You know, you should be a lot nicer to him.
Why?
Because he could make a very bad enemy.
Know anyone who wouldn't?
Well, I'm glad you could make it.
I damn near didn't. What's new?
Nothing. Just this. The report on Lois Collins you asked me for. I found out that Lois Collins is playing house with Charlie the bartender.
That I know.
Here's a list of the bars where Charlie's been tending bar. The last one was a joint called the Bandwagon. He was fired last month. Now, those two blondes came in there frequently, and they knew Charlie, at least well enough to call him by his first name.
Go on.
But you know, there's a funny thing. Charlie's got a Hollywood apartment he's still paying rent on.
You mean besides the room at Collins?
That's right. He rented the room around the 28th of last month.
What'd you get on the apartment?
Nothing. It's the kind of a place where nobody knows anything about anybody. Although the guy across the hall did admit he heard girlish laughter from Charlie's apartment from time to time.
Charlie fits in there somewhere.
With which blonde?
I don't know. I got a hunch.
See you later. Well, keep in touch, will you?
I remember talking to the private eye, asking if Mrs. Fortner ever refused to ride with the old man when he was stiff. I told him I didn't know of any time she refused to ride with her husband. He was stubborn. He wouldn't let anyone get him a cab. He always drove, and she always rode with him.
Charlie Walsh was working here when the other investigator was here?
Yeah. You fired him? Look, I ain't making any charges against Charlie. He was popular with the dames, but I let him go. I make just as much dough. There's a lot less liquor going now. I still don't say he stole from me. I just got rid of him. He didn't seem to mind.
Nah. Nothing ever really wrong with Fortner, except he didn't seem to pay enough attention to the missus. He can get riled now and then and put in a few extra rounds with some strangers, but she always left with him.
I used to have a drink with her myself once in a while. Nice lady. Nothing ever out of line, just talk. But he sort of got sore about it one night, though, and he cut things short and left in a huff, but she went with him.
Charlie used to work here.
Yeah.
Well, after he left, did he ever come in with the Fortners?
Nah. I know Charlie. He'd come in and talk to them when they happened to be here, but he never came in with them or anything like that. Charlie always used to give his friends matches with his address written on the inside.
Thanks a lot.
Yeah.
Been a big help.
Thank you.
Charlie's a nice guy. I thought he was tied into this deal the first time I saw him playing footsie with Lois. Now I know he is. Why else would he be so nervous? Well, what have you got besides a sore stomach? Only that Charlie knows all three blondes, and all three blondes know Charlie. He and Collins must have had something that was worth money. Maybe some Collins report. Did you find him?
He's waiting for you now.
Thank you. Where was Collins the night of the Fortner accident?
He was waiting in a bullpen. The record shows that.
What, at night?
That's right. Me, Ted Black, and Collins.
Well, it begins to add up. Yes, Collins' report was fine, except for one omission. An omission a good detective wouldn't make. Helen Fortner had never refused to ride with her husband before. Even at times when he was drunker than the night of the accident. And that's the important point that is not in the report. And for a good reason. And then there's Charlie. Charlie figures all the way down the line in this somehow. Because he was around when Collins was checking.
Where do we go from here?
I'm going to see Mrs. Fortner again. Good evening, Lewis.
Mrs. Fortner's not at home, sir.
I'd like to see your book.
My book?
The venues.
Yes, sir.
No coffee?
Not for Mrs. Fortner. Mrs. Fortner doesn't drink coffee.
No, I didn't think so. Did you hear me banging the pans around in here last night?
No, sir.
I'll wait for Mrs. Fortner. Thank you.
Well. Serve some drinks, Louis. I was most anxious to talk to you. I was going to call you. Are you going to have dinner with me tonight, darling?
No, I thought I'd take you out.
Oh, in that case, Louis, no dinner, and I won't be needing you for the rest of the evening. I was so anxious to talk to you.
What about? What's the matter?
Nothing. Excuse me.
Helen, you're in danger.
Don't be silly, darling. I enjoy danger.
Better grow up. I'm talking about the police. They're bound to catch up with you sooner or later.
I haven't done anything. You're not being very nice.
I think you better tell me exactly what happened to your husband and Bill Collins, all of it.
Oh, I haven't done anything. My husband had an accident.
What about Charlie?
The bartender?
That's right.
He was a nice boy, but I haven't seen him since he left that bar.
Where did you get these?
Oh, those. They're Charlie's. He gives those to all of his friends.
You're just not going to tell me the truth, are you?
I told you the truth. I wasn't very nice to you last night.
I thought you were.
No. You wanted some money and I didn't give it to you. How much do you need, darling?
Helen, did you give Bill Collins money?
Oh, yes, he needed it too. He was so nice to me. He asked me to go away with him for the weekend in a cab.
Did you go?
No. Charlie wouldn't let me. Let's forget it.
I don't know anyone else who'd be coming here at this hour. Detectives are checking on me.
Routine.
Well, I don't like it. Charlie says they're not police. He says they're private detectives like you are.
Charlie's smart. What are you doing up so late?
I couldn't sleep. I was lonesome.
You are expecting Charlie?
I told you I wasn't.
Is he in?
I don't know. I didn't see his car out front.
Where does he live?
Upstairs, room 16. Don't go. Stay and talk to me.
Talk?
Stay.
Be right back.
I'll be waiting.
Hello, peeper. All right, folks, let's through here. Come on, stand back. Let us through.
Book him.
I... I want a doctor.
Who are you? Duke Wallace, international insurance investigator. Book him.
What's the charge?
Suspicion of murder. Any accomplices? I'll come down and prefer charges.
He's all right.
You got a Band-Aid?
In my apartment.
Let's go get it.
Helen first met Charlie in the bandwagon. She wanted to get rid of her husband. Charlie wanted to make it permanent. Helen put a Mickey in her husband's drink and then refused to ride with him. He got sick and passed out near the end of the dead-end street. Charlie, who had been following in his own car, pushed Fortner's car over the cliff. He told Helen later how it was accomplished.
All right, type it up and check my reservation for New York, will
you? I'll do it right away.
You know, the thing that bugs me is, why did Helen squeal on Charlie?
Well, she didn't mean to.
There's a Mr. Adams here to see Mr. Wallace.
Just send her in. Got company.
Sit, Adam. Sit prettily. Sit, Adam. Duke Wallace.
Ma'am?
I need your help. My husband disappeared several days ago. You were recommended to me very highly by Helen Fortner.
Where'd you say you live?
I'll take you.
I know.
Don't call me, I'll call you.